We are launching into a new series of messages this morning, a series that I've called Touchy Subjects. And the reason I've chosen this title is because over the next 6 weeks, we're going to be talking about subjects that I have rarely, if ever, heard addressed in the morning worship service of a church. In fact, some of these I've never in my whole life heard addressed in any setting at a church. And as I've been preparing this series, I've been thinking to myself, why is it that we don't talk about these subjects? I suspect that for some of us, the reason we don't talk about some of these subjects is because they're not exactly polite conversation. I suspect for some of us, the reason we don't talk about these subjects is because, well, they have a tendency of stepping on my toes pretty hard. I guess for some others of us, we don't talk about these subjects because we know that we don't agree. And so we just don't talk about it at all so that we don't have to have any of those problems. There could be any number of reasons why we don't talk about subjects like the subjects we're going to be addressing over the next couple of weeks. To be honest, I think I'm a little nuts. Because it would be a lot easier for me to just keep avoiding these conversations. It would be a lot safer for me to do what most pastors that I know do. They sort of file these things away and hope nobody asks the questions. The problem, though, with that approach, the problem with the church not talking about these conversations is that it leaves the only voice on these subjects being the voice guided by the wisdom and ways of the world. A voice that, in case you hadn't noticed, doesn't exactly imitate God's voice on these subjects. My guess is that many of us gathered in this space today, our thoughts, our conversation, our behavior in a number of these areas, even with us, is far more shaped by tradition, you know, like what your mama's 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 mama said about it. Like, if mama's mama's mama mama said it, then it has to be true, right? Not necessarily. Let's step out of the way before the lightning strikes. A lot of us, when we come to some of these subjects, our opinion and our perspective is going to be ending up shaped largely by politics or by preferences. Because the church hasn't done a really good job of enabling God's people to think and speak and live biblically about these subjects, because we just keep quiet about them. Well, I'm just nuts enough to stop keeping quiet. I'm just crazy enough to break the silence. Hopefully, that means then that we'll be able to begin having biblical conversations. We'll be able to, in our thought patterns, begin thinking biblically. And as we think biblically and talk biblically, we'll find ourselves experiencing the blessings of living biblically about these couple of subjects. So for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about the following ideas. I'll let you decide which picture represents which thing. We're going to talk about human relations. We're going to talk about issues of peace and war. We're going to talk about drug abuse. By the way, we're going to be against that, just in case you wondered, okay? We're going to talk about gambling. We're going to talk about pornography. We're going to wrap it all up with everybody's favorite subject, the occult. So, like I told you, there are some subjects here that I've never heard addressed in church ever. So that's what we're going to be doing together. And I want you to know that these aren't just six random topics that I've picked willy-nilly. When's the last time you heard anybody use the word willy-nilly? I'm just that nuts. These aren't just six topics that I've picked out of the air. You see, the Prince Street Church is part of a denomination, a global denomination, that has always been at the forefront of social action, has always been at the forefront of taking God's word and applying it to the social concerns and issues of the day. For example, one of the reasons that we as the United Brethren of Christ have very few churches south of the Mason-Dixon line is because we go back a long, long time, hundreds of years, okay? We as a people were always on the forefront of the abolitionist movement. So that doesn't make you really popular below the Mason-Dixon line between in the middle of the 1800s, right? So that, you know, that's just who we are. You know, we look at God's word and say, all right, what does God's word have to say about this subject? How will this inform how we think and speak and live about this subject? The United Brethren Church has always been on the forefront of these kind of conversations. And over the years, we as a people have studied issues, studied subjects biblically, and put together what I think are some really outstanding statements about a variety of subjects. You know, for example, that at our last national conference, we received a report on the subject of human sexuality. If you haven't read that yet, I would encourage you to go to the United Brethren website and read that document because it is outstanding. Our guys did a great job. I shouldn't say guys. Our delegates did a great job of writing a biblical response in a compassionate way about subjects of human sexuality. Well, these statements on social concerns are found in our book of discipline, we call it. And these things are gathered under the heading called social standards. So what I'm sharing with you are the six areas that are covered in the United Brethren discipline. There's lots of other things that we can talk about, but that's what we're going to be doing over the next 6 weeks. And here's how we're going to shape it. I'm going to start each week by introducing the subject and talking a little bit about what it looks like to live by the pattern of the world in this subject. Then we're going to go to Scripture, and I'll warn you right up front, there's no way we have time to cover all the passages of Scripture that relate to these subjects. Instead, I'm just going to pick out a couple of foundational passages and let you dig those things out on your own throughout the course of the week. But then we're going to go, and I'm going to read the statement that we have prepared in discipline on the subject that does a really nice job of building practical application upon the foundation of Scripture. And then each Sunday, I'm going to wrap it up by giving you one concrete thing that you can do to put God's word into practice in your life throughout the course of the week. So that's where we're going over the next 6 weeks. If that excites you, bring friends. If it scares you, join the club and bring friends. And we're just going to trust God to take us through this series as we explore his word together. But before we get to the subject of human relations today, let's pray together. Father, thank you for choosing to reveal yourself to us. Thank you for choosing to reveal how you've made us. Thank you for your guidance in your word on how to live in relationship with you and with each other. God, thanks that the Bible isn't just some old dusty book of old doctrines that are irrelevant today. God, your word is living and active. It addresses the very real life things that we face every day. So God, we pray that through the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, that you would lead us in truth. And we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Well, most of you know that our family enjoys sports a lot. And one of our favorite sporting events is the Olympic Games. Whenever the Olympic Games come on, whenever they're either they're summer or winter, our family traditionally spends way too much time in front of the television. One of my particular favorite events of the entire Olympic Games is the opening ceremony. I love the pageantry, I love the music, I love the culture and the history that are presented. But I think my favorite part is the parade of nations. Because like half the nations I've never heard of before. And And so we watch as group after group after group, the youth of the world gather on in that stadium, and they celebrate this unity that regardless of whether you're from Asia or North America or South America or Africa or Europe, I don't care where you're from, we all have the same identity. And everyone has equal value. We are Olympians. I love that. Unfortunately, that spirit fades quickly, often before the Olympic Games even come to a close. You know, life, according to the wisdom and ways of this world, don't recognize everybody as equal. Don't value everyone as equal. Don't see everyone that way, as the events in Charlottesville just yesterday just horrifyingly demonstrate. Life, according to the wisdom and ways of this world, seems to be one of division, of lifting ourselves up by pushing other people down. And I know that we wouldn't actually say it out loud. Well, I guess there was an engineer that used to work at Google that broached the subject this week. We don't really want to talk about that, but just look at our behavior. You know, the history of the world is largely written in stories of conquest and bondage. Even in a country as wonderful as the United States, this land that we say was founded on the idea that all men are created equal, even we can't figure out what that means. And throughout the course of our experience as a nation, have struggled to live into that idea. This is life according to the wisdom and ways of the world when it comes to the subject of human relationships. Of course, God's plan and God's perspective on human relations is a whole lot different than life by the wisdom and ways of the world. And there's no way for me to fully explore every passage of Scripture that addresses the subject, but I do want to cover two very specific passages this morning because they lay a solid foundation upon which we can build a better understanding, we can build a biblical understanding of the subject of human relations. And we begin with a passage right from the very beginning of the book. I mean, one of the very first things that we're told that God's word tells us about humans is this. Genesis chapter 1, beginning at verse 27. God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Now, the reason that I wanted to start with this passage is because it gives us a bottom line. It gives us a bottom line for every person, every human that has ever lived. And that bottom line is simply that God created humanity in his own image. You know, humans are not like any of the other created species. We're not like any of the other creation in all the world order. As you read through Scripture, you find that everything else was created and reproduces itself after its own kind. Everything except humans. God's word makes it clear that humans are special, that we are created in the image of God. And although I don't have time this morning to explore all of what that means, to be created in the image of God, it does give us this baseline concept that regardless of our gender, male or female, for that matter, even those among us who struggle from time to time with gender identity issues, every human being who has ever lived is created in the image of God. We have his divine imprint in us, his fingerprints on us. Every person is created
in the image of God.
Now, let me build on that. Let me take that one step further. In the book of Acts, we come across a conversation that Paul, the Apostle Paul, is having in Athens with the religious and academic elite of the day. He's speaking at a place known as the Areopagus. You can read about that in the book of Acts. But in the midst of his conversation, he's explaining that the God who created everything doesn't live in temples made by human hands. He goes on to say that, you know, the God who created everything, the God who created people, is not even served by people. And then he says this, Acts chapter 17, verse 26, from one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their land. So according to the Bible, not only do we share a divine imprint, we're also family. So what are we having for dinner? Because that's what we do in this community, right? All the family comes over, we have a big family meal. Wayne, what are we having for dinner? Fried chicken, all right. Green Village makes a good roasted chicken. That would work. We could all go there and tell them, hey, we're having a family reunion. Because we're all family. That's what it says, right? I'm not making this stuff up. That's what it says. From one man, from Adam and Eve, he made, that is God, he made all the nations. So regardless of our ethnicity, regardless of our race, regardless of our nationality, regardless of anything, we're blood related. We're made in the image of God. We have his divine thumbprint. And we're family. So if we're going to think biblically about the subject of human relationships, if we're going to speak biblically, if we're going to live biblically in this subject of human relationships, we need to keep in mind that regardless of all the ways that we may be different, that every man and every woman, every white and every black, every Asian, every Latino, every American Indian, every Native Alaskan, every Pacific Islander, every American and every Russian, every Mexican and every Syrian, every Kenyan and every German, every person who has ever walked on the face of the planet, and every person who will ever walk on the face of the planet has a shared identity. We are created in the image of God, and we have a shared bloodline. We're all family together. So what does that look like when it comes to application? What does it look like to live out this foundational idea that we're all created in the image of God? Well, for that purpose, let me take you to the statement that we've crafted and communicated in discipline. It's printed on your note sheet so that you have this as a reference, because I'm going to warn you right up front. There's a whole lot here, and there's no way I can even touch much of any of this morning. But I do want to read it for you so that you've at least heard it and that you can be wrestling through these ideas through the course of the week. The church, by the way, that's you, that's me, that's us. This is, as United Brethren people, this is what we believe Scripture calls of us. The church respects human personality, which is inherent in every race, nation, and creed. We believe in the Bible's instruction that there is no basis whatsoever for a belief in the superiority or inferiority of any people. Therefore, the church protests against any action or practice that produces discrimination based upon racial, national, creedal, or social differences, since God made from one every nation of men to live on the face of the earth. The church admonishes all members to commit their attitudes, actions, and influences in faithful witness to this truth and to oppose every influence, whether it be economic, social, moral, or religious, which would debase, impair, or bring into bondage those whom God has created in his own likeness. Turn the page and buckle in, because wait till you hear this. The church believes that there must be equal rights and justice for all. All members should register their concern and opposition to any form of prejudice that would prevent any individual or ethnic group from free and full participation in the privileges and benefits of our society. We advocate through due process of law and within the framework of the democratic system the elimination of poverty, the abolishment of unemployment, a fair wage in every vocation, fair practices between employer and employees, adequate provisions for the aged and for those who are unemployable, the opportunity for decent housing for all, and a proper concern for total human need in our contemporary world. The church acknowledges that mankind's basic need is for the saving grace of Jesus Christ, and is therefore committed to the telling of the good news of the gospel to all persons. But the church also recognizes the commandment to love all men in the name of Christ. Therefore, the church admonishes all members to strive for a society characterized by unselfish compassion and service to all. And by the way, if you'd like to read through the scriptures that all this comes from, they're provided there for you so that you can be digging that out and praying through that throughout the rest of the week. There's a lot there. There's a lot I could point to, but I promised you that I'd close each week with at least one specific way that we can put God's word into practice. And because at the end of the day, discipline provides us some good things to think about and some good direction on how we ought live. But it's God's word that serves as our rule and guide for how we shape our lives. So I want to talk to you just briefly about something specific you can do to put God's word into practice. You know, so often we perceive people by what we see. We perceive people by how they look, by how similar or how dissimilar they are. Sometimes we get beyond that and we start talking, well, do they agree with me? How similar to the way I view life or dissimilar is that person? Often, before we've even taken the time to get to know a person, we've made assumptions about that person. And you know what happens when you assume, right? You're often wrong. So let me give you an example of one way that you can put God's word into practice this week. And on August 24th, wow, I just blew right past it. Sorry, Dan, you're good. There's the way. Honor the image of God, which is inherent in every person. There's your take-home point. If you haven't filled in that blank yet, go ahead and take the time to do that. It's on there for you. Honor the image of God, which is inherent in every person. Now, on August 24th, new students arrive on the Shippensburg University campus. Wow, did you hear that? That didn't sound like honoring the image of God that is present in every person, is it? You know, but we have that reaction, don't we? You know, before we don't even know these kids. And I get it. I live the challenges with you. But what if, instead of reacting by our assumptions, what if we chose to see in every one of those new students the image of God? What if we chose to honor the image of God that is present in each one of those students? So when you've gone into Sheets to get that quart of milk, you know, and there's a whole line of new students all getting all their fancy drinks and everything, you know. Now you know what frustrates me. But what if we chose to see the divine imprint? What if we chose to honor the image of God. Or you were at Walmart, and there's way too many of those students, because they should have gotten that stuff at home. Why didn't they go shopping before you? Okay. What if instead of seeing the difference, what if we chose to see the similarity? What if we chose to see the image of God in that student who's very different than ourselves? Or you're at the intersection at Sheets, and it's time to go, and that kid in front of you is on the phone. Put it away! Right? You know? I told you, I'm here with you. You know, this is all of us. What if in that moment we chose to see and honor the image of God? What difference would that make in our reaction? Because here's what I want to have you keep in mind as they come. Every one of those students that's coming for their first semester at Shippensburg University could be a Shannon Staver, could be a Joey Sudo, could be a David Bullock. Walking into their very first semester in a strange place, having no idea which way to go, having no idea what to do, overwhelmed by everything they're facing. What if we, the people of God, chose to see in these students these precious gifts that God is bringing to this community? What if we chose to see and honor the image of God that's inherent in each and every one of them? Well, before we go rushing out the door and into the craziness of the rest of our day, we want to give you some time to think, some time to ponder, to reflect. And so during this next song, I want to invite you to use this time to reflect. Maybe during the song you want to just jot a couple of notes to yourself in the back of your note sheet. Maybe you'd like someone to pray with you or have someone to talk to. We've got some folks in the back who are going to be standing there waiting for you. If you would like to be anointed with oil and prayed for, Jared's down front here. If you'd just like to be alone in prayer, the prayer rail is here. Or maybe you want to really do something crazy and sing along. You know, I don't know what it is that God is calling you to do in response to his word, but in these moments, I encourage you to respond in whatever way the Holy Spirit leads you. Right?